आईईटी एनसीईआरटी प्रेजेंट्स करिकुलम बेस्ड सीरीज ध्वनि शाला. सो लेट्स ज्वाइन इन ध्वनि शाला क्लास 7.
हेलो माय यंग फ्रेंड्स, आई एम योर फ्रेंड अंजलि. आई होप यू ऑल आर इन साउंड हेल्थ एंड टेकिंग गुड केयर ऑफ योरसेल्फ. सो आर यू एक्साइटेड फॉर टुडेज लर्निंग? Dear children, today we are going to study chapter 2 of class 7 science textbook, that is nutrition in animals. First of all, let us recall what we know from our first chapter, that is nutrition in plants. I will ask you a few questions and you try to answer those questions. Which method is used by plants to prepare their own food? Yes, correct. Plants prepare their own food by the process of photosynthesis. What about animals? Yes, animals cannot prepare their own food. Hence, animals get their food from plants either directly by eating plants or indirectly by eating animals that eat plants. Also, there are some animals that eat both plants and animals. I hope this gets clear to you. Children, let us see what we are going to learn about nutrition in animals. First, different ways of intaking food. Second, digestion in humans. Third, digestion in grass-eating animals. Fourth, feeding and digestion in amoeba. So children, can you name the components of food which we have discussed? The components of food are carbohydrates, fats, proteins, vitamins, and minerals. All these which I have listed are required by all organisms and including humans. Food is required for growth, repair, and functioning of the body, which we have already discussed. Animal nutrition includes nutrient requirement, mode of intake of food, and its utilization in the body. The components of food are complex substances. These complex substances cannot be utilized as such by our body. So they are broken down into simpler substances, which can be easily absorbed. The process by which these complex components are taken into the organism's body and broken down further into simpler substances is called digestion. Let us first discuss different ways of taking food. The mode of taking food into the body varies in different organisms. You might have seen in fans of humans and many other animals, which feed on mother's milk as their food. Another example is bees and hummingbirds, which suck the nectar of plants as their food. Another example, snakes like the python swallow the animals they prey upon. And you might have fed some aquatic animals also, or seen them eating tiny food particles which are floating nearby around them. So, amazing marine organism is starfish, which feeds on animals covered by hard shells of calcium carbonate. After opening the shell, the starfish pops out its stomach through its mouth to eat the soft animal inside the shell. The stomach then goes back into the body and the food is slowly digested. So, did you see how starfish obtain its food? And did you find it interesting? I really hope you did. And we will be discussing many such interesting examples further. Here comes the first activity for the day. What is the type of food and mode of feeding of different animals, like scraping of insects by ants, sucking nectar by bees? Write down your observations by finding more examples of this type. Students, now we will discuss about the digestive system in us humans, that is you and me. Now, how do we digest food? What are the organs involved? And what are the processes involved in these organs? We will learn all about this. We take in food through the mouth, chew it, and swallow it to digest. Nutrients are absorbed into the body and further they are utilized. The unused part of the body are defecated. Have you ever wondered what happens to the food inside the body? This whole process requires a lot of organs. The food passes initially through a continuous canal which begins at the buccal cavity and it ends at the anus. The canal can be divided into various compartments. First, the buccal cavity in the mouth. Second, food pipe or oesophagus. Third, stomach. Fourth, small intestine. Fifth, large intestine ending in the rectum. And sixth, the anus. Is it not a very long path? These parts together form the alimentary canal, also known as digestive tract, which facilitates the digestion process. Whereas the digestive system is a complete system which comprises the alimentary canal along with other digestive glands and organs like salivary glands, gallbladder, liver, pancreas, which secretes digestive juices for the better digestion. When the food components gradually get digested as food travels through the various components, what do they do? The inner walls of the stomach and large intestine and the various glands associated with the canal, such as salivary glands, the liver, and the pancreas, secrete digestive juices. The digestive juices convert complex substances of food into simpler ones. The digestive tract and the associated glands together constitute the digestive system, as we discussed. Now let us know what happens to the food in different parts of the digestive tract. First, let us study about mouth and buccal cavity. The process of digestion starts from our mouth, from where the food is taken into the body. The process of taking in food into the body is called ingestion. Students, you know that to chew food we use our teeth, and you might have noticed that all our teeth are not similar. We have different sets of teeth in our mouth. Each tooth is rooted in a separate socket in the gums. They vary in appearance, size, and perform different functions. Our teeth are of four sizes: incisors, canines, premolar, and molar. Incisors are used for cutting and biting of food, and they are 8 in number, 4 in the lower jaw and 4 in the upper jaw. Canines are used for tearing and piercing the tough food. They are total 4 in number, 2 in the upper jaw and 2 in the lower jaw. After this, the teeth which help in chewing are the premolars and molars. Premolars are 8 in numbers, 4 in the upper jaw and 4 in the lower jaw. And molars are 12 in numbers, 6 in the upper jaw and 6 in the lower jaw. All these teeth together help in chewing the food properly by breaking it down mechanically into smaller pieces. Do you remember about the falling of your teeth some years ago? It is because the first set of teeth grows during infancy and they fall off at the age between 6 to 8 years. These are termed milk teeth. The second set that replaces them are the permanent teeth. The permanent teeth may last throughout life or fall off during old age or due to some dental disease. Here comes the second activity for the day. But before doing this, wash your hands thoroughly. Look into the mirror and count your teeth. Use your index finger to feel the teeth. How many kinds of teeth could you find? Take a piece of an apple or bread and eat it. Which teeth do you use for biting and cutting? And which ones are for piercing and tearing? Also find out the ones that are used for chewing and grinding. This will help you to understand how many teeth do you have and which one helps in cutting, biting, piercing and tearing. Our mouth has the salivary glands which secretes saliva. Do you know the action of saliva on food? Let us find out by an activity. Take two test tubes, label them A and B. In test tube A, put 1 teaspoonful of boiled rice. In test tube B, keep 1 teaspoonful of boiled rice after chewing it for 3 to 5 minutes. Add 3 to 4 ml of water in both the test tubes. Now pour 2 to 3 drops of iodine solution in each test tube and observe what is a change in color in the test tubes. The result will show that both test tubes containing rice will show different colors. We know rice contains starch. An iodine test shows color appearance only when the substance has starch present in it. The rice, which is unchewed, will show a darker blue-green color because the boiled rice has starch present in it. But the chewed food will not show any color. Why? Because the chewed food has no starch, so it appears colorless. This confirms that saliva converts starch into sugar. Hence, the role of saliva is to soften the food and convert saliva into sugar. Children, as we are talking about buccal cavity, so how can we leave behind the strongest muscle in our mouth? Can you guess what it is? Yes, it is our tongue. The tongue is a fleshy muscular organ attached at the back to the floor of the buccal cavity. It is free at the front and can be moved in all directions. Do you know the functions of tongue? We use our tongue for talking, and you might have seen its main function is to mix saliva with the food during chewing so that we can swallow it easily. But there is another major function of the tongue. We also taste food with our tongue. It has taste buds that detect different taste of food like salty, bitter, sweet, and sour. This is all possible because of our tongue. Here comes the third activity for the day, by which you can find out the position of taste buds by the following activity. Prepare a separate sample, each of sugar solution, common salt solution, lemon juice, and juice of crushed neem leaf or bitter gourd. Blindfold one of your classmates or friend and ask him or her to take out the tongue and keep it in a straight and flat position. Use a clean toothpick to put the above samples one by one on different areas of the tongue. Use a new toothpick for each sample. Ask the classmate which areas of the tongue could detect the sweet, salty, sour, and bitter substances. Write down your observations and also ask your friend which of the taste do he or she likes the most. Children, you should also know that to keep our teeth healthy, we should brush twice a day for a healthy digestive system. Normally, bacteria are present in our mouth, but they are not harmful to us. However, if we do not clean our teeth and mouth after eating, many harmful bacteria also begin to live and grow in it. These bacteria break down the sugars present from the leftover food in our mouth and release acids. These acids gradually damage the teeth. This is called tooth decay. If it is not treated in time, it causes severe toothache and in extreme cases result in tooth loss. Chocolates, sweets, soft drinks, and other sugary products are the major culprits of tooth decay. Therefore, one should clean the teeth with a brush or datun and dental floss at least twice a day and rinse the mouth after every meal. Also, one should not put dirty fingers or any unwashed object in the mouth. The swallowed food then passes into the food pipe or oesophagus. The food pipe runs along the neck and the chest. Food is pushed down by the movement of the wall of the food pipe. Actually, this movement takes place throughout the alimentary canal and pushes the food downwards. Can you think why food moves in the opposite direction during vomiting? This is because at times the food is not accepted by our stomach, or because of indigestion, it is vomited out. Children, sometimes when you eat in a hurry, talk or laugh while eating, you may cough, get hiccups or a choking sensation. Why this happens? This happens when food particles enter the windpipe. The windpipe carries air from the nostrils to the lungs. It runs adjacent to the food pipe. But inside the throat, air and food share a common passage. then you might think that how food is prevented from entering the windpipe? During the act of swallowing, a flap-like valve closes the passage of windpipe and guides the food into the food pipe. If by chance food particles enter the windpipe, we feel choked, get hiccups or cough. So student, this is the reason that your elders say that we should never talk while eating. Do you know children, till year 1822, we didn't know how our stomach functions. No one has ever seen a stomach till that time. The working of the stomach was discovered by a strange accident by a man named Alexis Saint Martin, who was badly hit by a shotgun. The bullet had seriously damaged the chest wall and made a hole in his stomach. He was brought to an American army doctor, William Beaumont. The doctor saved him, but he could not close the hole properly and left it bandaged. Beaumont took it as a great opportunity to see the inside of the stomach through the hole. Isn't it interesting? He made some wonderful observations. He found that the stomach was churning food. Its wall secreted a fluid which could digest the food. He also observed that the end of the stomach opens into the intestine only after the digestion of the food inside the stomach is completed. It was strange but very true. So children, food travels through the oesophagus to the stomach. What is actually the stomach? The stomach is a thick walled bag. Its shape is like a flattened J, and it is the widest part of the alimentary canal. It receives food from the food pipe at one end and opens into the small intestine at the other end. The inner lining of the stomach secretes mucus, hydrochloric acid, and digestive juices. The mucus protects the lining of the stomach, and the purpose of acid is to kill bacteria that enter along with the food and make the medium in the stomach acidic, and it also helps the digestive juices to act. The digestive juices break down the proteins into simpler substances known as amino acids. Now children, the food from the stomach enters into the small intestine. Would you like to make a wild guess about the length of the small intestine? You will be fascinated to know that the highly coiled small intestine is about 7.5 meter long. That is almost the length of an elephant from the trunk to the tail. Just imagine how such a long structure is accommodated in a small piece within our body. It receives secretions from the liver and the pancreas and processes the food. Besides, its wall secretes juices. Where the liver is located? The liver is a reddish-brown gland situated in the upper part of the abdomen on the right side. It is the largest gland in the body. It secretes bile juice that is stored in a sac called the gallbladder. The bile plays an important role in the digestion of fats. The digested food further comes down into the pancreas. The pancreas is a large green-colored gland located just below the stomach. The pancreatic juice acts on carbohydrates, fats, and proteins, and it is responsible for changing them into simpler forms. The partly digested food now reaches the lower part of the small intestine, where the intestinal juices completes the digestion of all components of food. The carbohydrates get broken down into simple sugars such as glucose, fats into fatty acids and glycerol, and proteins into amino acids. These all can be absorbed by our body easily now. The digested food now passes into the blood vessels in the wall of the intestine. Here another process takes place. This process is called absorption. How does the process of absorption takes place? The inner walls of the small intestine have thousands of finger-like outgrowths. These are called villi, and in singular it is called villus. Can you guess what the role of villi could be in the intestine? The villi increases the surface area for absorption of the digested food. Each villus has a network of thin and small blood vessels close to its surface. As a result, the surface of the villi absorbs the digested food materials more effectively. the absorbed substances are then transported via the blood vessels to different organs of the body, where they are used to build complex substances such as proteins required by the body, or carbohydrates which are broken down into sugar or glucose are transported to the cells, wherein with the help of oxygen they are converted into carbon dioxide and water, and energy is released. This process is called assimilation. The food that remains undigested and unabsorbed enters into the large intestine. The large intestine is wider but shorter than small intestine. It is about 1.5 meter in length. What it does? Its function is to absorb water and some salts from the undigested food material. After absorbing water and salts from the material, the remaining waste passes into the rectum and remains there as semi-solid feces. The fecal material is removed through the anus from time to time for defecation. This process of sending feces into anus is called ejection. So children, we learned here that nutrition in humans is a complex process which includes the steps of ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation and ejection. Now we will learn about digestion in grass-eating animals. Have you noticed cows, buffaloes and other grass-eating animals chewing their food continuously while eating and even when they are not eating? Why do these animals cannot chew food properly at the time they take it in? It is actually they quickly swallow the grass and store it in a part of stomach called as rumen. In ruminants, the stomach consists of four parts. Here, the food gets partially digested and is called cud. But later, the curd returns to the mouth from time to time in small lumps and the animal chews it. This process is called rumination and these animals are called ruminants. What is the reason for this type of digestion in grass-eating animals? As a matter of fact, the grass is rich in cellulose, a type of carbohydrate which is difficult to digest. Many animals, including humans, cannot digest cellulose. But in ruminants like cattle, deer, etc., bacteria present in rumen help in digestion of cellulose. Animals like horses, rabbit, etc. have a large sac-like structure called cecum, which is placed between the small intestine and their large intestine. The cellulose of the food is digested here by the action of certain bacteria, which are not present in humans. As a result, these animals are easily able to digest it. We humans do not contain this bacteria, so we are not able to digest the grass. Children, so far we have learned about humans and animals which possess the digestive system. But have you wondered what is the process involved in a single-celled organism? You will be surprised to know that there are many small organisms which do not have a mouth and a digestive system. Then how do they acquire, process and digest food? Now we will learn about this another interesting way of food intake. One such example is amoeba. Amoeba is a microscopic single-celled organism found in pond water. It consists of a cell membrane, a thick nucleus and a vacuole. Amoeba constantly changes its shape and position. It pushes out one or more finger-like projections, which are called pseudopodia. Pseudo means false and podia means feet. So they have false feet for movement. With the help of pseudopodia, it captures its food. Amoeba feeds on some microscopic organisms. When it senses food, it pushes out pseudopodia around the food particle and engulfs it. The food becomes trapped in a food vacuole. Digestive juices are secreted into the food vacuole. They act on the food and break it down into simpler substances. And this digested food is gradually absorbed by the body. The absorbed substances are used for growth, maintenance, and multiplication. Whereas the undigested residue of the food is expelled outside by the vacuole. the basic process of digestion of food and release of energy is practically the same in all animals. They take in the food, break it down into simpler substances for energy, and excrete the waste material. Children, now let us recapitulate what we have learned today. We have learned a lot today. Animal nutrition includes nutrient requirement, mode of intake of food, and its utilization in the body. The human digestive system consists of the alimentary canal and secretory glands. It consists of the buccal cavity, oesophagus, stomach, small intestine, large intestine ending in the rectum, and anus. The main digestive glands which secrete digestive juices are the salivary glands, the liver, and the pancreas. The stomach wall and the walls of the small intestine also secrete digestive juices. The modes of feeding vary in different organisms. Nutrition is a complex process involving ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation, and egestion. Digestion of carbohydrates like starch begins in the buccal cavity. The digestion of protein starts in the stomach. The bile juice is secreted from the liver. The pancreatic juice is secreted from the pancreas, and the digestive juices from the intestinal wall completes the digestion of all components of food in the small intestine. The digested food is absorbed in the blood vessels from the small intestine. The absorbed substances are transported to different parts of the body. Water and some salts are absorbed from the undigested food in the large intestine. The undigested and unabsorbed residues are expelled out of the body as feces through the anus. The grazing animals like cows, buffaloes, and deer are known as ruminants. They quickly ingest, swallow their leafy food, and store it in the rumen. Later, the food returns to the mouth and animals chew it peacefully. Amoeba ingests its food with the help of its false feet or pseudopodia. The food is digested in the food vacuole. So this was all which we have learned today. Hope you have a deeper insight about digestive system in humans, grass-eating animals, and organisms without digestive system. Let me tell you an interesting fact before saying goodbye. Do you know, fats in goat's milk are much simpler than those in cow's milk? Therefore, the goat's milk is much easier to digest than the cow's milk. So this was all for today. Stay safe, eat healthy, and keep learning. Thank you.
You are just listening to curriculum-based programs, Dhwani Shala. Production assistants, Meenakshi Kukreti and Jagbandhu Jana. Recorded by Bati Langlingdo, produced by Ajit Horo. This program was brought to you by CIET NCERT, New Delhi, India.